Christ. We thank you, Lord, for keeping us throughout the night and for waking us up to partake of the morning manna. We ask, Lord, for understanding for the section of our brains that need to function, to be able to resurface the information and to put two and two together. We pray, Lord, that we might have further responsibility and experience to test these things and to share the truths that we're coming to God with. Fellow brethren, Adventists, to warn them of the coming crisis. We thank you, merciful Savior, be with us now and grant us wisdom and understanding and sanctify this place through your presence and your angels. In Jesus' name. So we'll preach you very soon.
Overflow. And who is it that overflows?
the king of the north. And Tiberius signifies which president?
Trump.
The 45th. How did the king of the north enter the Soviet Union? By revolution. And how is it symbolically illustrated? In Daniel 11:40. He shall do what? Overthrow and pass through. And then Daniel 11:41 says what? He shall also enter into the glorious land. What did we say the word also means? In a similar way. In a way similar to how? To how he entered the Soviet Union. He's always going to enter the United States. Right? But you know that things can happen in opposites, right? John was typified by Elijah. Elijah doesn't die, John dies. What needed to happen for the Soviet Union to collapse? The what? Yes, the federal power had to be weakened. We know what we mean when we say federal, right? The central government, right? That was holding everything together. It had to be weakened. Because the Soviet Union was a centralized government, right? There was a one-party dictator that was controlling the Soviet states. So what needed to happen is that those states needed to be free from that central government. So the central government had to be weakened. Its grasp over the states had to be loosened so that the states would disintegrate, right? They could leave the USSR. But when it comes to the United States, when the papacy enters the United States right now has what? Strong central, state governments. We know that, right? If you watch the news, like when the gay laws were passed, you can hear that the state of Virginia did not want to participate. You see, they've got states' rights, right? But if there's a Sunday law that needs to be passed and the whole of the United States needs to subscribe to that Sunday law, what needs to happen to the United States? What do you need? A strong central government, a dictatorship, right? So there's an opposite, right? But it's the same. That's how prophecy works in many cases. So he overflows, so he's also going to overflow. Also, the word also shows us that it's the same. Overflow here, overflow there. Now there's many ways that you can illustrate these truths. On a line. You can show that the characteristics of 1989 repeated a midnight cry. Right? Here you've got a battle between North and South, right? Which the North wins. And at the midnight cry, you've got a battle happening between North and South, and the North wins. We follow. It's the same principle. So those characteristics are there marked. So when we looked at Tiberius Caesar, we saw that what did he do to the capital? He abandons the capital. And that, what we say a capital is a symbol of? A place of strength, right? You remember in Daniel 11, it talks about Rome. It says the sanctuary of strength. So the city of Rome was to move for a time from the strongholds, from the capital, from the city of Rome. So a capital is a symbol of a strength, a place of strength. So when Tiberius moves from the capital city, what is he abandoning? The place of strength. What's the place of strength for the United States at the end of the war? The Constitution. So when Tiberius Trump abandons the Constitution, what did we see being developed in the time of Tiberius? We saw two parallel kingdoms, right? Rome and Capri, right? And he rules in Capri for 10 years. And Capri means gold, right? Because the United Nations identified as a gold in the scriptures, right? And the 10 kings, the God. And the historians will tell you that from that point onwards, Tiberius became a dictator. That's when he became a tyrant from that point onwards. And he goes on to incite what you call a reign of terror. The historians call his rule what? The reign of terror. When his son had been killed, when the kingdom is not given to his posterity, Tiberius becomes a mighty king, a tyrant, right? Who's persecuting people. Yes. So we put that and we showed you the historical reference where the reign of terror is linked with the reign of Tiberius Caesar. They actually compare the French Revolution with the reign of Tiberius Caesar. But it also says, yea, also the prince of the covenant shall be broken. So when the nation is broken by a revolution, who's also broken?
Prince of the covenant. Who's the prince of the covenant? Christ. So, can you separate the revolution from the cross? Yes, but the cross is there. And when you look at Daniel, Revelation 11, so for Daniel 11, Revelation 11, 11, 11, got a doubling there, those 11s, and Revelation 11 talks about the French Revolution. And does the French Revolution talk about the breaking of Christ? Yes. Sodom in Egypt, where our Lord was crucified. Right? It is the French Revolution. So we have these 11s. So 11, 11, that's 22. Daniel 11, 22. Those things. Right? So you have those. And then we, yeah, we put that in place. So let's go to page 33. So there's much that can be said about the history of Tiberius, but on page 32, page 33, want to look at the beginning of the French Revolution, right? Who knows when the French Revolution began? Because it typifies the American Revolution. No, 1793 was the radical phase, it was the reign of terror, but the revolution had begun before. 1789. The historians mark the storming of the Bastille, that's how you pronounce it, the Bastille, the Bastille. They mark that as the beginning of the French Revolution. So the very day that the storming of the Bastille took place is the very day that they had a constitutional convention in France. Before. So we're going to read here. Okay, let me begin at page 33 where it says, the revolution during Tiberius' time breaks this rule, and also Christ was broken during Tiberius' time. So it's not an accident that the Bible is making the connection of the cross and the revolution, whilst the historians are connecting Tiberius and the French Revolution. The French Revolution identifies the breaking of the two witnesses and says they are broken in Sodom in Egypt, where our Lord was crucified, showing that there is a direct connection between the French Revolution and the slaying of Christ in Egypt. Because we understand that the first Passover, which typifies the cross, was kept in Egypt. So the Prince of the Covenant was broken in Egypt during the reign of the fourth Pharaoh, because the Pharaoh associated with the narrative is actually the fourth Pharaoh noted in scripture, and thus he lines up with Tiberius, who is the fourth Caesar, who was dead, who has the Prince of the Covenant broken during his rule. Pharaoh's kingdom was also not given to his posterity because his son was killed. Now I'm going to explain what I just said. How many? I said that Pharaoh is the what? Fourth Pharaoh, right? In the scripture. Do we know that? How many of us are familiar that the Pharaoh associated with Egypt and Moses, the Passover, is actually the fourth Pharaoh? You know that, right? Who's the first Pharaoh? The Pharaoh that has an interaction with Abraham. When Abraham leaves Haran, right? And then that Pharaoh wanted to take Abraham's wife, Sarah. And what does the Lord do to his kingdom? He sends plagues, right? Punishment. So you have the first Pharaoh. And who's the second Pharaoh? Joseph's Pharaoh. Isaac had an interaction with Abimelech. Yes, Joseph's Pharaoh. You follow? And who's the third Pharaoh? No. The Jacob Pharaoh is Joseph's Pharaoh. Who's the third Pharaoh? Moses. Right? The Pharaoh who initiated the bloodbath when Moses was born. But that Pharaoh dies in Egypt. And then the Lord tells Moses, the people that sought your life are all dead. Right? And Pharaoh sought his life. So then the Pharaoh who's there at the Exodus will be Pharaoh number what? Four. So he's the fourth what? King. Right? So who does he typify? If he's the fourth king? Trump. Right? So in the time of that fourth Pharaoh noted in the scripture, which dynasty was he from? When he died, which dynasty did he end? The 18th. Okay, so but he ends a dynasty nonetheless. It was the end of nine of Pharaohs when he drowned in the Red Sea. But we follow the logic. In the time of the fourth Pharaoh, it was the Passover. And the Passover typifies the cross, right? Yes. But in the time of the fourth Caesar, we have got the crucifixion of Christ. You see the parallels? You see that? Everyone. So we're saying there's a connection between, there's a direct connection with Egypt and the French Revolution in association with Tiberius Caesar. The Lord is making a connection. Fourth King, cross. Fourth King, Passover. So I said that this Pharaoh's kingdom is also not given to his posterity, if we follow the logic. Because was Pharaoh's son not killed? Yes, so the kingdom was not given to his posterity. So that Pharaoh is Alexander the Great. You follow? Do you follow the logic? Yes. But this son was it his youngest son or his firstborn? It was his firstborn, right? Now let's look at what the firstborn is a symbol of in the Bible. The firstborn is a symbol of, firstborn is a symbol of the constitution in one level. Genesis 49:3. Reuben, thou art my firstborn, my might, and the beginning of my strength, the excellency of dignity, and the excellence of power. Excellency of power. Now, so what's the firstborn a symbol of? Strength. Strength, right? Psalm 105, verse 36. You smote all the firstborn in their land, the chief of all their strength. So upon two witnesses, the firstborn is associated with what? Strength. Right? So when Tiberius Caesar loses his firstborn son, he became a dictator. So when the United States loses its strength, it's going to turn into a dictatorship. And what's the strength of the United States? The Constitution. So when the Constitution is repudiated, what is that going to result in? Dictatorship, right? Despotism. Fourth. So I've defined it here. So I'm just going to read this. The strength of the USA is its constitution. So the American Revolution is really a theme in scripture. The French Revolution began with the Constitutional Convention, and the Reign of Terror followed. And Louis XVI was the fourth Louis. Thus, he typifies the 45th administration. Therefore, before Louis XVI, it was a line of Louis who ruled. But when the whole system of which Louis was presiding over was destroyed when France introduced the constitution, and the line of the Louis ended, and they executed Louis, and Robespierre became the dictator. So the kingdom was not given to Louis' posterity, but was plucked up for others even besides those. The French Revolution began in the time of Louis, but his father, the tax raiser, had said, "After me, the deluge." So what I'm saying is this, there's a line of four Louis, right? I'm not going to prove all of that now, but there are four Louis that are noted in history. There's a sequence that you have to follow. And Louis XVI, who's there when the French Revolution began, is the fourth Louis. You follow? So who does he typify? The fourth king, because it's all about the fourth, right? It's all about, when you see a fourth king, contextually it's the fourth king. So he's the fourth Louis, right? The 16th, he was the fourth Louis in a line of certain line of Louis. Louis XVI, number 4, the 15th, number 3, the 14th, number 2, the 13th, number 1. So these, there are four Louis, these ones. It was a line of four Louis. But there's a sequence that you have to follow. But it's four, if you look in the history. You follow the logic. But before Louis XVI, he had his father, Louis XV. And Louis XV was a tax raiser, so who would Louis XV be? Obama, because he's before Louis XVI, and Louis XVI is the fourth, right? And if you read in the Great Controversy, when Sister White is talking about the French Revolution, Louis XV, the tax raiser, knew that his administration had messed up France. He knew that he'd done it. He knew that he'd just done it. And he actually says, "After me, the deluge," right? So he's saying, when you leave the throne, what's following? A deluge. Right? If you read in the Great Controversy, type the words, "After me, the deluge." Sister White talks about that, about Louis XV. Now I want to define a deluge. So I've got here the Webster's definition for a deluge. A deluge means any overflowing of water, an inundation, a flood. So what's a deluge? An overflowing. So after me, the revolution. And did the revolution come after Louis the 15th? Yes, it came in the time of Louis the 16th. So Louis the 16th is the fourth Louis, who took Christ, the 45th president. So in the time of the 45th president, you were to have a flood, a revolution. The American slash French revolution. We follow. Right? So now, want to look at the intricacies associated with the French Revolution, how it began. It began by France seeking to introduce a constitution. We follow. They wanted to get rid of the old government, and they were now introducing a new constitution. A constitution. So I've got the Wikipedia extract there in your notes. I'm not going to read everything. But in boldface, okay, I'm just going to read a bit, actually. When the summoning of the States General, a National Assembly that had not been called since 1614, was announced, he issued an appeal entitled A la Nation, okay, and the rest. I'm trying to look at where I left off. To the people of Atoll, on the March of 1789, the citizens of France chose the necessity of reforming their states. Sorry. Someone continue reading. Something's happening.
The very weak of the 8th deputies of the 3rd estate. That's it, the gave political career at the end of the day.
Okay, you can pause right there. So when they call it this constitutional convention in France, they've got a representative person that they want to preside over this constitution, right? When the French Revolution is beginning. And that person is Robespierre. And how old is Robespierre? He's 30. Where do we place the number 30? Midnight. You see why it was necessary to build all these, because now time things together. We showed that you can plant the number 30 there. So, the French Revolution is beginning when? The American Revolution in this case. At midnight. And Robespierre is presiding over them. Right? They're now overthrowing the existing government. But we're going to see Robespierre is going to turn into a dictator. Because he's the one that's there when the Reign of Terror takes place. You follow? Because he's the one who ends up introducing the national race, the guillotine, into France. Right? So this is the beginning of the American Revolution, typified by the French Revolution, because Robespierre is 30. We're going to do some connections with the number 30. But also there were 12, they mentioned something. It was a 12-member constitutional committee, so there were 12 members here at that constitutional convention. We'll look at that in a later study. Now let's go to page... So I'm going to read this comment here on page 37. Robespierre claimed to represent the common people, and his popularity was growing. He was elected as one of the representatives of the Third Estate in the Estates General, the French version of a national convention, in 1789. As I alluded to in the previous email, this would be at midnight as well. It is interesting that he began his political career at the age of 30. And based on the lines of the prediction before midnight, which you are familiar with, we can mark the number 30 from 9/11 to midnight. This is Joseph beginning his political career as a prime minister of Egypt at the age of 30, following the prediction about the approaching famine by an east wind at the midnight cry. And we can also place the story as fulfilling at midnight. So Trump's career as Robespierre's would really begin in earnest at midnight. It is also interesting to note that Robespierre was subject to the repeated attacks of the royal press, and one of the allegations against him was that he wanted to create a constitutional assembly. Trump is currently on the receiving end of repeated attacks and criticism from the mainstream media, which is controlled by the elite or the establishment. I am not sure about frugality, dress, and grooming, but in other respects, Trump is typified by Robespierre. Other witnesses to the number 30 at midnight are from Ezekiel 1 itself, which was in the fifth day of the fourth month. It was in the 30th year. which we have come to understand is at midnight. Ezekiel sees his vision in the 30th year, and the heavens are opened. And in the baptism of Christ, the heavens are opened, and Christ is stood. This is what we did in the first presentation, right? Okay. So now, let's follow this logic. So we are saying, how old is Joseph at the beginning of his political career in Egypt?
30.
And what was Joseph doing there for him? You're centralizing power, right? If you take time to read Genesis 40 to 46, just read those chapters. You're going to see that when Joseph is doing that work, he's taking the money of the people, isn't he? He's having power over the precious things of Egypt, or the apple Pharaoh. But if you look at Daniel 11, 42, what are we told about the papacy? It should be 42 or 43. Let's just go there. Daniel 11, 42, 43. But ye shall have power over the treasures of gold and of silver, and over the precious things of Egypt. So the papacy is going to have power over what? The treasures of gold of Egypt, right? Of Egypt. But who's going to give the papacy that power? Who's the ships and the chariots of the papacy? The United States. And what the ships represent? Economics. So who's the one that centralizes the economy and surrenders it to the papacy? The United States. So who's Joseph? If he's centralizing power to surrender it to Pharaoh, he's the United States. So this showing you that in the history, when the revolution is building up, there will be a centralization, a consolidation, as Brother Tabo has been putting it, of wealth and power in the United States. When that centralization takes place, it's introducing a new government, which is going to surrender those treasures for the papacy. Right? There's a moral authority as the head of that one world government. You follow? Yes. Because for him to have power over those things in verse 43, someone needs to give him that power, which is the United States. Because the United States has got power to give life unto the image. So when Joseph is doing his work, he's 30, which we're placing here, where you place the number 30. And if you read in Genesis, it says Joseph was made ruler over Egypt. But Egypt is a symbol of what? Oh, so he's the ruler of what? Oh, so who's he? So Joseph is 30, and then he gathers corn for how long?
7 years.
But if you look in the Bible, I'm not going to prove some of these things, it's in the notes, but the notes have. He gathers corn for 7 years. But Jacob, when does Jacob come?
After 2 years of the 7 years.
Yes, after 2 years of the 7 years. Everyone, it's up to you to test it on your own. But we're saying that Jacob comes into Egypt to reunite his son when the famine was already 2 years in. Before, right? So Joseph does a work of gathering corn for 7 years. Can we put the number 7 from midnight to midnight, right?
Yes.
We can. What's our witness? Christ begins his first trial at what time?
Midnight.
At midnight, and then he goes through 7 trials. And what happens at the 7th trial? I mentioned it already, but I was using a different factor. The people cry, Barabbas, Barabbas, crucify him, crucify him. What do you have there? A doubling. Can you put a doubling here?
Yes.
Yes, and when they do that, they begin the procession to the cross. Can you mark a procession at the midnight cry? Yes. This is the bridegroom is coming at the midnight cry in procession format, right? The procession to the cross, right? So you can put the Joseph gathering his corn for 7 years from midnight to the midnight cry. Before, you can put the number 7 there. And is there a shut door at midnight?
Yes.
Yes. And what follows every shut door from the reform lines? The number 7. From the reform lines, the basic reform line, shut door number 7. Close of probation, 7th day. Right? Shut door, Sabbath test, 7th day. You follow? So it's the structure of the reform line. Noah preaches for 120 years, shut door, 7 days waiting in the ark. Elijah judges the prophets of Baal, judgment, shut door, 7 times prays for rain. So you can put the number 7 there. So I'm saying if what's his name?
Joseph.
Jacob comes in 2 years into the famine. I'm not putting this on a scale. I'm just trying to put the number two so people see it. Because I'm saying the famine, the gathering of grain ends here at the midnight cry. Up to seven times, right? So, seven, yeah? And then 2 years later, this is not a scale. I think these 2 years, I think they go here, if you're being technical. But 2 years in, so if you count from when Joseph begins his work of consolidating to when Jacob comes, how many years is that in total? 9 years, 7 plus 2, right? 7 plus 2. And how old was Jacob when he came into Egypt to meet Joseph?
130.
He was 130. He was 130. So if he was 130, 9 years from when Jacob began his work, how old was Jacob 9 years before? 121. Can you mark the number 21 there? July 21. That's why I wanted to. Yes.
You're saying from midnight right, number 7.
Yes.
Then the second procession is the first from midnight cry.
To the midnight cry. From the midnight cry.
From the midnight cry.
It's the procession.
Where is the cross?
The cross is the Sunday law. That's the basic reform line. We've always understood the Sunday law to be the cross. But the cross is a symbol. You can mark it any way you want, because the cross is the center of everything, right? It's all about the cross. These reform lines are about the cross, right? Isn't it? Yes. So you can put the cross there, cross there, cross there, depending on what you're teaching. If you're marking the reign of terror, we're putting the cross at the midnight. But if you're just using the structure of the reform lines, this is the cross, the sign here. Different application. But symbols are what dual applications are more.
Okay, you don't put a cross, two crosses in a line.
Okay, is that a comment?
Yeah, in one line, in the sense if you're illustrating one line, you can't put two crosses in one line.
Okay, if it's a comment, let's reserve comments. But if it's a question, let's take it. We need to comment in the spare time. So, sorry, because of time. I want us to move. Right? Yeah, okay. Yes, so I put that in place. Then we're at a page where it's written core soul judgments. I want us to follow carefully. I don't want anyone to be confused here. Let's follow closely. Core soul judgments. Right? We permit you to think that you can put the trumpets at the waymarks, right? 1989, first trumpet. 9/11, second trumpet. Midnight, third trumpet. Midnight cry, fourth trumpet. We follow? Yes. The Christian Coalition under Pat Robertson, 1989. Right? Pat Robertson with the 700 Club. He's Alaric of the first trumpet. It's the document when that is being worked on by God's grace given when it's out. 9/11 is the second trumpet, Islam. Right? Midnight is the third trumpet, Russia. The Midnight Cry is the fourth trumpet, the Trump administration. We follow? It's not proving everything, but that's the structure of the thing. So here it says, the four trumpets of Revelation 8 can be placed at the particular waymarks which we've already identified. Would like to show a few prophetic connections as we go. A trumpet in the Bible can also be understood to be a warning. So let's just drop down. A warning. Joshua 6:4. And seven priests shall bear the ark and seven trumpets of ram's horns. Verse 5. A long blast with the ram's horn when he shall hear the sound of the trumpet. So a trumpet can be understood to be what? A horn. Because how did you make trumpets?
Ram's horns.
Ram's horns, right? So if you can put four trumpets at the waymarks, what can you put is already done? Four horns. We follow. You put four horns. One number one, one number two, one number three, one number four. Because the trumpet is a horn. They interchange it. We follow. Okay. We together. Okay. Right. A horn can be understood to be a trumpet as well. So the four trumpets are four horns. What is the purpose of the four horns? Zechariah 1 verses 18 and 19. Then lifted I up mine eyes and saw, and behold, four horns. And I said unto the angel that talked with me, what be these? And he answered me, these are the horns which have scattered Judah, Israel, and Jerusalem. So what's the purpose of the horns? To scatter. So what do the four trumpets illustrate? A scattering, but is it instantaneous? So what is it? It's a progressive scattering. You follow? Because even if you look in the history of the trumpets, these were judgments on Western Rome. But they were progressive, leading up to the dissolution of the Western Roman Kingdom, the end of Western Rome, at the fourth trumpet, and other old ways. So when you get to the fourth trumpet, it's the end. And these trumpets are judgments upon who in our time? The United States, right? Yes, the United States is Western Rome, isn't it? Yes. So, the United States is Western Rome, and just meet once again. Rome was divided into how many sections? There was East and West. But when Western Rome was divided, did Rome totally cease to exist? Eastern Rome continued on. When you get to Sunday law, when the United States is destroyed at the midnight prayer, is every other nation destroyed? No, you're going to have the 10 kings continuing to exist, which can be typified by Eastern Rome. Before. So that logic, the United States is Western Rome, then the whole world, the rest of the world is Eastern Rome. Before? Yes, just based on the structure of six kingdoms falls, but the seventh kingdom continues. Western Rome falls, but the Eastern Roman Empire continues. Okay? The purpose of the horns is to scatter. So the four trumpets, trumpets represent a fourfold scattering. And when the Lord scatters his people in a fourfold manner, we see it connected with the seven times of Leviticus 26, when the Lord scatters his people, and it does it in a fourfold fashion. So the four seven times of Leviticus 26 and the four trumpets can be overlaid over the top of each other because they identify the same truth. The four trumpets are also called plagues in Revelation 9:20. And you can see that they are because of their description, because their description is similar to the plagues that came upon Egypt. The four seven times are also called plagues. Leviticus 26:21. In Daniel 11:3, we are told that when the mighty king stands, this kingdom, the USA, shall be broken and divided towards the four winds. And we understand from Daniel 8:8 that this division towards the four winds is identified as four horns towards the four winds. So we see that is identifying a fourfold scattering of the United States, beginning at the midnight cry. When the mighty king begins to stand, then Jerusalem can be marked as the midnight cry, because of Ezra 7:9, the triumphal entry into Jerusalem, and the Greeks in Desire of Ages 68, chapter 68, will come to inquire because they've heard of the triumphal entry. Now I'm going to explain. What I just said here is this. The four horns scatter Israel and Judah, don't they? So they represent a scattering. But it's a fourfold scattering. And where do you see a fourfold scattering illustrated in the Bible? What are the, when the Lord now gives you the characteristics of that scattering, where do you see it? Leviticus 26. Because in Leviticus 26, how many times does the Lord say, I'll scatter you seven times?
Four times.
So the four times of Leviticus 26 then give you the characteristics of what it is like when the Lord scatters you. Do you follow? Zechariah 8 shows you that there are four horns that scatter. But Leviticus 26 repeats and enlarges and shows you the characteristics associated with that scattering. It then identifies the characteristics. Do you follow? Right? Zechariah doesn't show you the characteristics, it just shows you the horns. But when you look in Leviticus, it shows you what the horns have done. You follow? So you can plug the four seven times of Leviticus 26 over the top of the four trumpets and the four horns. Do we follow? Huh? Repeat and enlarge. So in Leviticus 26, I'm saying here, when the mighty king stands, this is where I don't want us to be confused. When the mighty king stands, what happens to his kingdom? It's divided towards the four winds. When does the mighty king stand? At the midnight cry onwards, right? Before. So there's a division of the United States into four parts in this history. Do you follow? Do you follow that logic? When does the mighty king stand? At the midnight cry, and when he stands, what happens to his kingdom? It's divided into four parts, right? So I'm saying, when is the United States divided into four parts? At the midnight cry, right? You follow the logic. Yes. So what does it mean that the United States is going to be divided into four parts? I like to ask the question because it poses to trouble me. So I want to ask her. What does it mean when it's divided into four parts? Is it going to be divided into four parts? Yeah, revolution, true. Okay, let's go to. We said the Mount Jerusalem at the midnight cry. Right? Now, let's read Ezekiel 14, verse 13. Son of man, when the land sinneth against me by trespassing grievously, then will I stretch out my hand upon it. This is why I have my hand here. So when the land sins grievously, what does the Lord do? He stretches out his hand. Right? But we're going to see where he stretches out his hand. Verse 21. For thus saith the Lord God, how much more when I send my four sore judgments upon Jerusalem. Where's Jerusalem? At the midnight cry. So the midnight cry, what does the Lord send?
Four
sword judgments. Now let's read what these four sword judgments are. The sword, famine, pestilence, and noisome beasts. Right? So what are the four sword judgments that are coming upon the United States when the Lord stretches his hand upon Jerusalem at the midnight cry? Four sword judgments. So one of the things that's illustrated by the division of the United States into four parts is the Lord sending four sword judgments. You follow? So there are four sword judgments that come in this history. But, we know that, so this is what it means when the Lord is going to divide the United States into four parts. He's sending four sword judgments upon the USA. You follow? It's not a, maybe it can be a literal division, I don't know. Some people are still grappling with it, but it's four sword judgments, right? So, these judgments can be warned. Do we follow the logic? Because it's divided towards the four winds into four parts. And these four parts are the four sword judgments. So these judgments can be the horns. So the famine will be a one, wouldn't it be? Famine equals one horn. The pestilence equals another horn. The sword equals another horn. The noisome beast equals another horn. So the kingdom is divided into four parts. So if we follow our logic as we've been going on with it, if these four sword judgments are four horns, right? If they are four horns, and we can line up four horns at a particular waymark, 9/11, 1989, midnight, and the midnight cry, what can you do with the four sword judgments? You can line them up with what? Because they are four horns, and you just agreed that these trumpets are horns from here to here. So if these are four sword judgments, if they are four horns, what can you do with these four sword judgments? You can line them with the waymarks. You follow? In a different, you are teaching a different truth. But the principle is the same. So we are saying, where would you put the sword? It's there, but 1989. Why? Why would you put the sword in 1989? Okay, the first trumpet. Remember we said these trumpets are players. If you study the characteristics of the trumpets in Revelation 8, are they not the same as the plagues in Egypt?
Yeah,
because the first trumpet is hail mingled with fire. And when the Lord was sending the plagues upon Egypt, did you not see hail mingled with fire? Yes. The second trumpet is the ships of Kittim. And the ships of Kittim, they destroy a third part of the creatures in the sea. In the plagues in Egypt, you see a judgment upon the creatures in the sea. Yes, water turning into blood. Right? You follow the logic? Yes. So the characteristics are the same. And Revelation 9:20 then tells you that these trumpets are plagues. You follow the logic? So, in the plague of... So if the first trumpet is hail mingled with fire, can you associate hail with war? How? With war. How can you associate hail with war? Hmm? Yes, there's blood. Hail means that there's blood. But if you look at hail in the Bible, the Lord says, I have reserved hail for the day of battle and war. It's a sword for yes, so this is the sword. It lines up the hail. You fall. 9/11, what Islam, and what we know that Islam does. What did it do at 9/11? He had struck, and what did it cause? Financial crisis in biblical terms was a financial crisis. A famine. So you can overlay the famine there. You see? So upon two witnesses, the first two already fit. It means that the last two are fit. Right? You follow the logic. Yes. Pestilence. Where would you put the pestilence? I don't know if I have a proof text for this in here. But where would you put the pestilence? Well, midnight cry. Where would you put the pestilence in the midnight cry? What's pestilence? Pestilence is what? It's a disease. It's a disease, right? Can you mark a disease here at midnight? Yeah? Let me try and pull out the quotation that shows us that quickly. We're looking at the trumpets of the winter school, so I didn't put the references there because I didn't want to prove it, but I guess I need to. If he was able to pull up those, brother, you know the references by head that connect the pestilence with disease with the wound.
Hosea 5:13.
Hosea 5:13. You say it happens to the United States at midnight. What does Russia do to this? It strikes, but what did we say yesterday? It what? It wounds the United States. Remember we said it yesterday. So there's a wounding here. But what is a pestilence? It's a disease, isn't it? Okay. When Ephraim saw his sickness and Judah saw his wound, then went Ephraim to the Assyrian and sent to King Jehu. Yet he could not heal you, nor cure you of your wound. Right? So sickness is associated with the wound. And sickness is a disease. And the disease is pestilence. You follow? So there's a pestilence that's coming upon the United States. But the pestilence is Russia. It's going to wound the United States. You follow? It's a symbolic pestilence. Do you follow the logic? Yes. Yet the United States is wounded. There's a pestilence, pestilential judgment that comes upon it here. When Jehu was anointed as king, what had just happened to the king of Israel at that time? What had Hazael done to him? He had wounded him. And when did we say Jehu was anointed? At midnight. So at midnight, what would have Hazael, the Russian, done to the United States? Wounded it, and the wound is the disease. Right? We follow. So it's the pestilence. Can we put noise on beast here? At the midnight cry. What are beasts? Kingdoms. Can you see kingdoms coming in at the midnight cry? Which kingdoms? The 10 kings. Important. So the four soul judgments fit. Now question, the trumpets were judgments upon which part? When you see, when you sing in reference to the trumpets, it's identified as a judgment upon which part? A third part. It's a third part, right? So let's go to the notes. Ezekiel 5:12. Okay, let me read this extract first. I will not labor to give proof texts that are there for these because it's in the public record and the document on the trumpet is being put together that makes these applications in a more detailed fashion. Ezekiel is going to mention those four soul judgments, but this time you will substitute noise and beast with all winds. So in this particular narrative, there is a division towards all winds and the midnight cry under the fourth scourge. Do you see my point? Ezekiel is going to repeat the same four soul judgments, right? But instead of saying noisome beasts, he's not going to say noisome beasts. He's going to say all winds. So we're going to see famine, pestilence, the sword, and all winds. Do you follow? Yes. Ezekiel 5:12. A third part of thee shall die with the pestilence and the famine. You see that? So it's mentioning a what? A third part. It's confirming that you can line up the four sword judgments with the trumpets. Because the trumpets are judgments upon a third part. So a third part of thee shall die with famine and with pestilence. And he goes on to say, shall they be consumed in the midst of thee? And a third part shall fall by the sword round about thee. And I'll scatter a third part of into all the winds, and I'll draw to sword after them. Verse 17 is going to be written in large. So will I send upon you famine and evil beasts, and they shall bereave thee, and pestilence and blood shall pass through thee, and I'll bring a sword upon thee. I, the Lord, have spoken it. So do you see this? The four sword judgments are upon a third part. Sword upon a third part. Famine upon a third part. Is the United States a third part? Mm-hmm. It's the third part of what? Of modern Babylon, right? Revelation 16. Third part of the United States is the third part. These are the dragons and the false prophets. And then here the Lord scatters them into all winds, right? Mm-hmm. His kingdom shall be divided towards the four winds. You follow? Mm-hmm. Right? I think I've already mentioned this. Identified it. Now, this is where we'll look at this and we'll close here. The trumpet for what? What's another word for trumpet? A horn? What else? A plague? Right? A plague. So you have prophetic justification to take illustrations of plagues that fit the context and overlay them over the trumpets. When the Lord sends this forceful judgment, what does he first do upon Jerusalem? What does he do? He stretches forth his hand, right? He stretches forth his hand. And we've said that these forceful judgments can be broadened and you can overlay them on this line. We follow. So when the Lord is now sending the last four plagues in Egypt, what does he do? He stretches out his hand. For those who watched Elder Jeff's presentations last year, Potola dealt with this. The Lord stretches out his hand at the midnight cry, right? And in the last four plagues in Egypt, the Lord stretches out his hand. So this, I've got the reference there, Ezekiel, Exodus 9, 15. Okay, 9:14. He's talking about the last four plagues. For I will at this time send all my plagues. So the last four plagues are identified as all his plagues. So if they're identified as all, can you separate them? Which means you want to relate to them as what? As one unit of thought. You have to take them as a line. You follow? Yes. Upon thine heart and upon thy servants and upon thy people, that thou mayest know that there is none like me in all the earth. For now I will stretch out my hand, that I might smite thee and thy people with pestilence, and thou shalt be cut off from the earth. So, who knows what the last four plagues were? By description. What is the first of the last four? Hail. Already, can you not see that you can line it up with 1989? Because the first of the last four plagues was Hail Me with fire. And the first trumpet is Hail Me with fire. So, you can put the last of the first four plagues, the first of the last four plagues, the Hail at 1989. And what was the one that followed after the hail? Locust. Can you put locust at 9/11? Classic, we know that one, right? Who's the locust? Islam. And what was the one that followed the locust? Darkness. And how long did that darkness go for? 3 days. I think we'll read that one. Let's go to the notes. Where it says Psalm 91, verse 5. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness. You see that connection? Where are we marking the pestilence? At midnight, but that pestilence walketh in darkness. And the third of the last four plagues is darkness. You see that connection, right? nor for the destruction that wasted at noonday. Is this noonday? This is noon, because this is midday, but this is midnight, right? Midnight, midday. When Christ is on the cross, was he on the cross at midday? Yes, he's on the cross at the sixth hour, which is midday. But what began to happen at the sixth hour? Darkness for how long? For 3 hours, for 3 days, up to the ninth hour. And when Christ is on the cross at the ninth hour, what does he cry? My God, doubly, midnight cry. You see that? So this is the 3 days, the 3 hours of the cross, right? Yes, so let's read. We're about to finish. Verse 10. There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. So you see this, connecting with the plagues. But Psalm 91, how does Sister White approach Psalm 91? In the Great Controversy. When she quotes Psalm 91, what is she dealing with? The time of trouble. In the time of trouble, which personage does she use to be a symbol of the time of trouble?
Jacob.
And what time did Jacob begin his time of trouble? At midnight. So you can plug that verse at midnight. You follow? Yes. 2 Samuel 14, 13. 24:13. 2 Samuel 24:13. So God came to David and told him and said unto him. So Gad came to David and told him and said unto him. No, isn't this supposed to be God? The typo, right? Yes. Yeah. Gad. Oh, okay. So Gad came unto David and told him and said unto him, shall 7 years of famine come into thy land? Or wouldst thou flee 3 months before thine enemies while they pursue thee? Or that they be 3 days pestilence in thy land? Verse 15. So the Lord sends a pestilence upon Israel from the morning even unto the time appointed. So the Lord sends a pestilence for how many days? 3 days. Darkness that walketh in Egypt for how many days? 3 days. So there's a strong connection with these elements which you can't ignore. You follow? Yes. So you have that there. And look at the last one. What was the last plague? Passover. Passover. Can you put Passover here? This is what we've been doing. This is the cross, isn't it? This is Passover. This is the reign of terror. Right? And in this history, which kingdom is rising? The UN. And the United States is divided into how many winds? All the winds. Right? Noisome beasts. But the UN is called how many kings? 10 kings. And the last plague was plague number what? 10th plague. Right? So you see that strong connection. So just in summary, let me pray. Do you follow the connection? The logic behind this. So what we're going to do in the next presentation, the God's place is, we're going to take the 4-7 times of Leviticus 26. We're going to take the individuals associated with the 4-7 times. Do you follow? Because the 4-7 times illustrate a progressive what? Scattering. And this is a progressive scattering. So this will be Manasseh, this will be Joachim, this will be Joachim, and this will be Zedekiah. I'm primarily going to be dealing with the fourth of these, right? But I just have to give you a structure. This will be Zedekiah. And you can show, that we're going to show that in the history, Jehu begins his career here, doesn't he? He does, right? This is where Jehu begins. He's anointed here, but he begins his work here, right? We show that Alexander the Great stands here, but he's anointed here. So if Zedekiah is here, it means he has to be anointed here. You follow? And the fourth trumpet, if it does its work at the midnight cry, it needs to be inaugurated at midnight. That's the logic that we're going to be following.
Amen.
So let's pray. Heavenly Father, come before you in the name of Christ. We thank you for the study. There are many lines of truth, Lord, and I pray that we could fulfill our individual responsibility and experience to go through these truths and test them out for ourselves and be able to teach unto others what we find to be truth. Now, as you carry on with the day, may you grant us wisdom.
peace and serenity, to surrender all to thee, and to be ready, Lord, to be part of the people you're going to use, Lord, to give the prediction of home and night, and to understand these truths, and to have a reformation worked in our lives. This is our humble prayer, in Christ's name. Amen.